I have a poem from my friend Maren Tirabassi. In imagination, I've seen Calvary from various perspectives. The foot of the cross with the faithful women and the disciple responsible for elder care. Or further, a crowd listening to forsakenness, cheering vinegar. Or the thieves meeting death themselves as people do in such different ways. Or furthest of all, the frightened followers. But this too is in the text in Rome or Galatia, I hear Paul say, clothe yourself with Christ. And I know I can't put on the seamless robe I gambled for and won. This character is true today with our new silent science and old hymns, our theology and our online platforms. We are still people who roll the dice for God and are forgiven what we know or don't know, what we've done or will do. Then, slowly, tenderly, stick an arm in the soft sleeve and put on Christ to learn to love the world. Maren Tirabassi. Will you join me in the call to worship that comes from Psalm 71? I'll read the parts in the Roman type and ask that you respond with the parts in italics. In you, O Lord, I take refuge.
Let me never to shame.
In your righteousness, deliver me and rescue me.
Incline your ear to me and save me.
Be to me a rock of refuge, a strong fortress to save me.
For you are my rock and my fortress.
Rescue me, O God, from the hand of the wicked,
from the grasp of the unjust and cruel.
For you, O Lord, are my hope,
my trust, O Lord, from my youth.
Let us pray. Most holy and merciful Father, we confess to you and to one another and to the whole communion of saints in heaven on earth that we have sinned by our own fault in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. Lord, we have not loved you with our whole heart and mind and strength. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We have not forgiven others as we have been forgiven. We have not been true to the mind of Christ, and we have grieved your Holy Spirit. We confess to you, Lord, all our past unfaithfulness, the pride, hypocrisy, and impatience of our lives, our self-indulgent appetites and ways, our exploitation of other people, our anger at our own frustration, and our envy of those who are more fortunate than ourselves. Father, we confess our intemperate love of worldly goods and comforts, our negligence in prayer and worship, and our failure to commend the faith that is in us. Accept our repentance, Lord, for the wrongs we have done, for our blindness to human need and suffering, and our indifference to injustice and cruelty, for all false judgments, for all uncharitable thoughts toward our neighbors, and for our prejudice and contempt toward those who differ from us. Restore us, good Lord, and let your anger depart from us. Accomplish in us the work of your salvation, that we may show forth your glory in the world. Hear that our God pardons and absolves all of those who truly repent, And therefore, we beseech God to grant us true repentance and the Holy Spirit, so that at last we may come to God's eternal joy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
And now, as Jesus taught us to pray, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Amen.
Let us stand and sing together, Ah, Holy Jesus, which is in the back of your bulletin. Is not a short psalm, but once a year I read you the whole thing. And the reason I read this to you is because it begins with the last words that Jesus said on the cross. He might not have had the energy to speak the whole psalm from the cross, but I have the energy to speak it. Yeah. It's hard at the beginning, but it comes to promise and light at the end. Good Friday is hard, but Easter is coming. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me from the words of my groaning? Oh my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer and by night but find no rest. Yet you are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel. In you our ancestors trusted, they trusted, and you delivered them. To you they cried and were saved. In you they trusted and were not put to shame. But I am a worm and not human, scorned by others and despised by the people. All who see me mock at me. They make mouths at me. They shake their heads. Commit your cause to the Lord. Let him deliver. Let him rescue the one in whom he delights. Yet it was you who took me from the womb. You kept me safe on my mother's breast. On you I was cast from my birth, and since my mother bore me, you have been my God. Do not be far from me, for trouble is near, and there is no one to help. Many bulls encircle me, strong bulls of Bashan surround me. They open wide their mouths at me like a ravening and roaring lion. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax, it is melted within my breast. My mouth is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue sticks to my jaws. You lay me in the dust of death. For dogs are all around me, a company of evildoers encircles me. My hands and my feet have shriveled, I can count all my bones. They stare and gloat over me, they divide my clothes among themselves, and from my clothing they cast lots. But you, O Lord, do not be far away. O my help, come quickly to my aid. Deliver my soul from the sword and my life from the power of the dog. Save me from the mouth of the lion. From the horns of the wild oxen you have rescued me. I will tell your name to my brothers and sisters. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you offspring of Jacob, glorify him. Stand in awe of him. All you offspring of Israel. For he did not despise or abhor the affliction of the afflicted. He did not hide his face from me. He heard when I cried to him. From you comes my praise in the great congregation. My vows I will pay before those who fear him. The poor shall eat and be satisfied. Those who seek him shall praise the Lord. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord. All the families of the nations shall worship before him, for dominion belongs to the Lord, and he rules over the nations. To him indeed shall all who sleep in the earth bow down. Before him shall bow all who go down to the dust. And I shall live for him. Prosperity will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord and proclaim his deliverance to a people yet unborn, saying that he has done it. Oh,
festival of unleavened bread, the chief priests and the scribes were looking for a way to arrest Jesus by stealth and kill him. For they said, not during the festival, or there may be a riot among the people. Then Judas Iscariot, who was one of the 12, went to the chief priests in order to betray him to them. Yet when they had heard it, they were greatly pleased and promised to give him money. So he began to look for an opportunity to betray him.
They went to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." He took with him Peter and James and John, and began to be distressed and agitated. And he said to them, "I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and keep awake." And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that, if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. He said, "Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. Remove this cup from me, yet not what I want, but what you want." He came and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter, "Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep awake 1 hour? Keep awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak." And again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And once more he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy, and they did not know what to say to him. He came a third time and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Enough! The hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand." Immediately, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived, and with him there was a crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, "The one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him and lead him away under guard." So when he came, he went up to him at once and said, "Rabbi," and kissed him. Then they laid hands on him and arrested him. But one of those who stood near drew his sword and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to them, "Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me, as though I were a bandit? Day after day I was with you in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me." All of them deserted him and fled.
They went out to the Mount of Olives, and Jesus said to them, "You will all become deserters, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered.' When I was with you day after day in the temple, you did not lay hands on me, but this is your hour, and the power of darkness." Then they seized him and led him away, bringing him into the high priest's house. But Peter was following at a distance. When they had kindled a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat down together, Peter sat among them. Then a servant girl, seeing him in the firelight, stared at him and said, "This man also was with him." But saying, "Woman, I don't know him." A little later, someone else, on seeing him, said, "You also are one of them." But Peter said, "Man, I am not." Then, about an hour later, still another kept insisting, "Surely this man was with him, but he's a Galilean." But Peter said, "Man, I do not know what you are talking about." At that moment, while he was still speaking, the cock crowed. The Lord turned and looked at Peter. Then Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said to him, "Before the cock crows today, you will deny me three times." And he went out and wept bitterly.
As soon as it was morning, the chief priests held a consultation with the elders and scribes and the whole council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate asked him, "Are you king of the Jews?" He answered him, "You say so." Then the chief priests accused him of many things. Pilate asked him again, "Have you no answer? See how many charges they bring against you." But Jesus made no further reply, so that Pilate was amazed. Now at the festival, he used to release a prisoner for them, anyone for whom they asked. Now a man called Barabbas was in prison with the rebels, who had committed murder during the insurrection. So the crowd came and began to ask Pilate to do for them according to his custom. Then he answered them, "Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?" For he realized that it was out of jealousy that the chief priests had handed him over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate spoke to them again, "And what do you wish me to do with the man you call the king of the Jews?" They shouted back, "Crucify him!" Pilate asked them, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more, "Crucify him!" So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas for them. And after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified.
Then the soldiers led him into the courtyard of the palace, that is, the governor's headquarters. And they called together the whole cohort. And they clothed him in a purple cloak. And after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on him. And they began saluting him, "Hail, the King of the Jews!" They struck his head with a reed, spat upon him, and knelt down in homage to him. After mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him.
It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. Two others also were criminals who were led away to be put to death with him. When they came to the place that is called the skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right hand and one on his left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they cast lots to divide his clothing, and the people stood by watching. But the leaders scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others, let him save himself, if he is the Messiah of God, his chosen one." The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine, saying, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." There was also an inscription over him, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who were hanged there kept deriding him and saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation. And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man, he has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." He replied, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise."
When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Then Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two, from top to bottom. Now, when the centurion who stood facing him saw that in this way he breathed his last, he said, "Truly, this man was God's son." There were also women looking on from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James the Younger and of Joseph and Salome. These used to follow him and provided for him when he was in Galilee. And there were many other women who had come up with him to Jerusalem.
When evening had come, and since it was the day of preparation, that is, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, respected member of the council, who was also himself waiting expectantly for the kingdom of God, went down to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate wondered if he was already dead and summoned the centurion. He asked him whether he had been dead for some time. When he learned from the centurion that he had been dead, he granted the body of to Joseph. Then Joseph brought a linen cloth and, taking down the body, wrapped it in the linen cloth and laid it in a tomb that had been hewn out of the rock. He then rolled a stone against the door of the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Jesus, saw where his body had been laid.
The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness does not overcome it.